Hello everyone, and welcome back to theCUBE's live coverage of the Red Hat Summit Ansible Fest here in beautiful Boston, Massachusetts. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight, alongside my co-host and analyst, Rob Strechay. Rob, this is what is always true about Red Hat Summits, is that you hear about the partnerships, the collaboration, the deep storied history between many companies.
I agree, and I think this is another one that has a great story leading back to what was announced on the keynote earlier today.
Well, indeed. So with that, I'd like to introduce our next guest. We have Chris Tobias, GM, America's Tech Lead Leadership and ISV Team Intel. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you, Rob. Very good to be here.
And Ryan King, Senior Director, Hardware Partners at Red Hat. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Excellent. So why don't we talk a little bit about this Red Hat Intel collaboration? Just as we said at the very outset, it is a long history.
Yeah, it's a very long history. We've been collaborating together all the time from RHEL hitting the marketplace up until now. Stack's latest benchmark launch was Xeon, and RHEL 9.5 and set a world record. So fantastic collaboration up until this day. And now we're collaborating on enterprise AI and with our latest Gaudi 3 accelerators. And as our CEO of product said today, Michelle Johnson, enterprise AI is Red Hat. So we are very closely tied together in our technology strategy and the belief in open community and software for AI.
It's an amazing milestone for the partnership.
Yeah, I mean, it seems that way. I think, again, the collaboration has gone on for a while, and you have a lot of joint POCs going as well. Why don't you talk to how the reaction has been from the customers? Because, and we look at it, and I think it's been a, like, I would say one of the themes of the stage today was really inference. And when we look at, there's a long tail of inference where it's not just going to be Gaudi 3 and accelerators. It's going to be a lot of Xenon and CPUs doing inference, especially as you get towards the edge and things of that nature. How, I mean, you know, hundreds of POCs sounds pretty substantial at this point in time.
Yeah, so our POC framework has different technical use cases. And now that like VLM becomes more central and on the stage for Red Hat, we're seeing a lot of interest for VLM-based POCs from our customers. And for those that don't know VLM, it's a layer that sits between the models and the accelerators. And it provides all those useful capabilities for them to run efficient and for things like memory management. If you read the original paper on it, it was all about like page memory attention and like taking like concepts that are known in operating systems, but applying them to a GPU. So like made like really simple for like a model to be able to, you know, make itself ready day zero for how it can best run on an accelerator.
So you think Red Hat, you think open source, and I know that this collaboration is really committed to fostering an open ecosystem for AI innovation. Can you talk a little bit, both of you, in terms of how you actually do that?
So we're open source first and always. Like, it's kind of just our DNA. Like, you wouldn't, you know, we think in the AI era, like, I draw back. Like, I actually worked 10 years at Intel and got drawn into the open source community. We actually lived in the same town. Like, it was, there's more history than just the company here. But back then, I was working early at Red Hat, and I was seeing, you know, I was working on Red Hat Enterprise Linux, and it was like this big enterprise push for Linux, and like, we're stabilizing it, making like enterprise ready. And then like I started to hear about what was happening in the cloud, and like I heard about a project from Google called the Borg, and I was like, oh God, what is that? And then people told me the technical capabilities of it, and it was like, holy cow, this thing can run like a cluster, like a single computer. It does all this great thing with containers. And he really like technologically got interested in it. And it was our then CTO, Brian Stevens, that worked with a few other Red Hatters, and they went into Google and they brought that project out, and that became Kubernetes, right? So like, there's this innovation that happens in different places, and then we start to work with the people that are the innovators, and we say, hey, look, how can we bring a more open like approach to this? And then once that becomes an open project and it becomes like a standard for everybody, we work on kind of our standard pattern, which is like, how do we make that enterprise ready, hardened, and like ready and suitable for like, you know, the global 1000?
When you look at this, and you brought up VLLM, and we had Brian on earlier actually, and we were talking very deep into some of the stuff around it.
Yeah.
It would seem, and even from an Intel perspective, this is extremely helpful in getting more out of it, because what customers seem to be concerned about is, you know, ROI and TCO in addition to the performance that you're talking about.
Yeah, absolutely. It lowers the complexity and ideally the cost of AI, and it connects the business case to the technology a lot faster at the high level. So that's where we want to go. That's what we're working towards. And by making and supporting it through the open source methodology, we expect to create a rally point for the industry to innovate around. So it's fantastic. And it's, as Ryan described earlier, that's the playbook we're following. It's been successful before. It's going to be successful again.
Yeah, I mean, simplifying that approach for, you know, both the front end, like the model, people creating the models and say like they just want it to work well and work quickly on the accelerators, the accelerator people to expose those features and next set of capabilities, you know, new quantization, those sort of things, new, you know, capacities in the GPUs. That's all great to bring those things together with like a single layer that we can expose. And then again, like back to our pattern, we'll support it, make it enterprise. And now we're announcing LLMD, which is a layer upon that, about how you can do distributed inference, which just, you know, takes it to the next level.
How are you thinking about security, which remains a top priority for so many customers? How are Red Hat and Intel teaming up, particularly for customers who operate in highly regulated environments and have a lot of strict compliance needs?
Yes, security is top of mind for Intel. For example, between Intel and Red Hat, we've launched some support for security measures that are inherent in the Intel silicon that will lower the attack surface, as you're running your workload. So there's a technology called TDX, and it basically lowers it to the application. So you have a very small attack surface there, for example. So we have extensive collaboration. And both Intel and Red Hat are deeply embedded in our DNA as how to minimize the security risks and minimize the attack surface as we put products out in the marketplace.
Yeah. So I think, again, and there's some exciting stuff with, you know, RHEL 10 around the post-quantum encryption stuff that, again, really exciting as well. But How does the
integration... The post-quantum era. It's there.
Yeah.
It's like fascinating, huh?
I'm sitting there. I'm like, okay, now we're going to go from, you know, 3,000 years to 10 seconds of cracking stuff with quantum. I'm like, I'm glad, you know, it depends on whose quantum computer you think and which methodology. Somebody says there's one out already. Others are saying that's out. Whatever. Say we're 3 to 5 years away from it being there. We still see a lot of companies really, you know, getting ready. But another thing they're getting ready for, and I think maybe, and you can talk to this, is really how Red Hat AI and RHEL AI and OpenShift AI really take advantage of Gaudi 3 and XENON. And how does that like integration really come to bear?
So VLM's predominantly, you know, focused on, you know, GPUs today, but the company started in the CPU space. So like, you know, we will continue to evolve like how this works across all sorts of accelerators. Today we are showing VLM with Gaudi 3 and I think two locations here on the floor and the capabilities and the performance and really like, you know, price performance and also performance per watt that, you know, Intel's very proud of.
Yeah, we just went through GA with IBM Cloud with our Gaudi 3 accelerators. A third-party company, Signal 6, measured cost per token and token output. Very competitive with all the other leading market accelerators out there. And compatibility is there for the full Red Hat stack from RHEL through Red Hat OpenShift. And it's something we've collaborated on. And one of the things we're very deeply collaborating on is making sure at that VLM layer, it looks seamless for people who are using VLM no matter what the hardware looks like underneath that.
We think of it as like the kernel is to, and an application is to like the CPU, like VLM is in between like the model and the GPU. So it's like a new paradigm of Linux, but now around VLM.
And then, as Ryan was saying, it originally started around CPUs. Well, at the time, CPUs didn't have some of the accelerated technologies we put in there for our advanced matrix extensions, which is a big cache and a big matrix multiply, which is perfectly suited for generative AI inference. And we're getting good results. We've had people actually migrate their workloads into the cloud from accelerators to CPUs because of the cost and performance capability of those.
So what is that unlocking for customers in terms of the transformations that you're seeing and how you work with customers? What opportunities is this creating for them?
So I think it's addressing two areas. It's minimizing complexity. Because you hear generative AI, I got to do something. What do I do? How do I connect my business process to the technology? And you can just get lost in that shuffle. So what we're working with Red Hat to do is minimize that complexity of what is the hardware architecture and what does all the infrastructure software look like and make that kind of seamless. So you can just worry about, hey, what kind of application do I want to go with and what kind of business problem do I want to solve? And then ideally, that gets you into a cost-effective solution, because right now you can spend your entire budget on AI, and if you're not sure what you want, you're not sure what you're going to get. So by minimizing complexity and minimizing costs, you make it much more accessible to effective enterprise business processes, and that's what they wanted to do to be more effective at compete in the marketplace.
I think it's depends who you're speaking with. So like, and I'm an ecosystem. So like when I talk to a GSI, it's all about them speaking to the CEO, right? And the C-staff and saying, here's the business processes we want to transform. And they're looking down into the agentic architecture and into the infrastructure and say, what's the best way to implement? And they have patterns and blueprints around that. And we pipe into that. And then I talk to like the hardware folks, and it's about how do we create repeatable patterns? And then how do we expand the aperture? Because like if you're looking at your infrastructure overall, you're going to look at both vert and AI and containers in one space. And what's unique and differentiating about Red Hat is like Kubernetes is a management plane across all of those, is really an amazing way of like looking at your transformation. Because when we talk to partners, they say, here's how we can take our current footprint in terms of power, and we can, you know, bring this down to a better power footprint profile, and we can make room for what we need in the AI space. And look at it as a row of racks, right? Versus, you know, just a distinct, what's my vert strategy, what's my containers, what's my AI? So from infrastructure wise, like we feel like we have a really strong position with our lead with OpenShift across all three areas.
That would seem like, and we've talked about this a little bit in, you know, I think with the current political things, you know, sustainability's kind of fallen out of favor, but I think saving power and watts is not out of favor. Like, because data centers are not getting more power. I mean, Eastern Virginia can't build data centers in Eastern Virginia right now because there is no power. So that must be one of the focuses as well. And
it absolutely is. So when you do the TCO calculation, power becomes the ongoing biggest contributor of that. And right now, with the AI options out there, power is following an exponential curve depending on where you choose. So BLM is actually a key tool in making the model size more effective and getting more out of the model size and getting better power performance and, you know, overall. So it's easier to implement for the IT shop. It fits in their ongoing, OpEx budget. Because people used to think about CapEx as they move to the cloud with the OpEx. The power equation is a big, big deal, and it comes up almost immediately no matter who you're talking to. It used to be just at the cloud providers. Now it's everybody.
Yeah, having been in one of those cloud providers in a past life, I can tell you it's everybody is where, and my friends who run data centers today are like trying to figure out what governments they have to talk to get more power for some of their data centers, which is insane.
It's interesting because it's like the neo-cloud world of like, hey, we're looking at, you know, inference itself. They're seeing what we're doing with LLMD, and they're like, they're seeing how it's a better way of serving up a bunch of inference, right, overall. So they're having conversations with that about, you know, as well as like sovereign AI and what they do in that space. And they love the security and the ability that, like, you know, it's Red Hat software, it's all open source. And so it's really kind of opened the door some new strategic conversations between us and different partners that maybe have been just building stuff in-house and are saying, hey, what you're doing here is differentiating. And to go back to your question on kind of like the power thing overall, like on one end, it's like we just continue to optimize this, and these are great strides forwards, but also on the other end, reasoning models come in, and agentic and multi-model interaction, and you know, we're looking specifically at VLM and around reasoning because we want to, I mean, you see this go up like 8x in tokens, you know, use like a deep research model, it does not come back quickly, right?
No.
So like there's a lot of work still to do, like on just, you know, because the technology just continues to take strides and taking more and more compute in order to achieve its means.
Yeah, no, I think it, to me, and kind of, you know, final kind of question from us is that, like you mentioned, like the size of models and things of that nature, and you know, the compression that VLLM can do on the model size. There's also, I think, and we look at it, we have a power law distribution of the Gen AI that I kind of mentioned earlier. And one of the things that we see is the long tail is inference. And what we also see is the size of models, not going to be these trillion parameter models out at the edge or far edge or something like that. They're going to be small or specialized, where SLMs, small or specialized models out at the edge. This would seem like having both the CPU and the GPU to be part of that AI ecosystem really seems a good way to drive that efficiencies as well. Because again, it's a cost, to your point, it was a cost and power and, you know, throughput type of discussion.
Yeah, absolutely. We're in the first rounds of generative AI discussion, and the amount of innovation has been amazing. I mean, VLM started, 2 years ago? Right, it's been a company that's been bought by Red Hat and fully integrated into their software strategy. So the rate and pace is amazing. And we've seen software techniques to get to some smaller model sizes. We've seen hardware techniques to make that more efficient. So are people going to use in their day-to-day inference architecture? I think that's still being figured out. Historically, up until now, inference on machine learning and deep learning was mostly CPUs. And then we got this, ChatGPT moment, and it took a huge model to expose the capability there, which was wonderful. But we realized in the day-to-day usage, you could get away with much smaller footprints, which has implications like power, you know, managing the security of the model, et cetera. So there's lots of ways for efficiency, which you could either take off the table as more capability, or you could take off the table as, you know, TCO savings. So it's very, very exciting to be part of this, and the game is far from settled on how this will play out.
That's great. Yeah,
absolutely. Chris, Ryan, thank you both so much for coming on theCUBE.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Stay tuned for more of theCUBE's live coverage of the Red Hat Summit Ansible Fest 2025. You're watching theCUBE, the leader in enterprise tech news and analysis.